Keep on praying, the Lord is nigh. Just keep on praying, He'll hear your cry. The Lord has promised, His word is true. Just keep on praying, He'll answer you. In the midnight hour, the Lord is nigh. In the midnight hour, He'll hear your cry. The Lord has promised, His word is true. Just keep on praying.
To our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we bless God for His goodness and His mercy. We just thank God for safe travels on yesterday to our planner session in Florence, South Carolina. Thank the Lord for His help and those things that He has provided for us this past week. Protection, divine healing, and all those other things that He's manifested. We praise God for His goodness.
Yes.
This afternoon we have a message we'd like to share with you coming from 2 Kings chapter 13. 2 Kings chapter 13.
Thank you.
And we'd like to look at verses 14 through 19. And then we'd like to finish at Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. When you have 2 Kings chapter 13, verse 14, please signify by saying amen. The word of the Lord reads, Now Elisha was fallen sick of his sickness whereof he died. And Joash, the king of Israel, came down unto him and wept over his face and said, O my father, the chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof. And Elisha said unto him, Take bow and arrows. And he took unto him bow and arrows. And he said to the king, of Israel, Put thine hand upon the bow. And he put his hand upon it, and Elisha put his hands upon the king's hands. And he said, Open the window eastward. And he opened it. And Elijah said, Shoot. And he shot. And he said, The arrow of the Lord's deliverance, and the arrow of deliverance from Syria, for thou shalt smite the Syrians in Ephek, till thou have consumed them. And he said, Take the arrows, and he took them. And he said unto the king of Israel, Smite upon the ground. And he smote thrice, and stayed. And the man of God was wroth with him, and said, Thou shouldest have smitten five or six times when thou hast smitten Syria till thou hast consumed it, whereof now thou shalt smite Syria but thrice. Our topic for this afternoon is simply this: when you stop just short of your total victory. When you stop short of your total victory. The Bible tells us that the prophet Elisha, who was the understudy of the prophet Elijah, was now on a bed of affliction. He was dying of a disease or sickness that he had. And the king Joash, who was a young king, comes to Elisha, weary, because he knows that the prophet has been a voice in Israel. He knows that the prophet has been a seer in Israel. The prophet has given directions. The prophet has given proclamation. The prophet has given answers. And now this king feels himself feeling as though he's going to be unequipped or all alone. So he comes to the man of God as he is on his bed of affliction, preparing to die. And the Bible says that the king cries out to Elijah and basically bequeath him not to die. But Elijah says to the man, says to the king, he says, take an arrow, a bow and arrow. And he says, open the window to the eastward. And he says, I'm going to grant you one more request from the Lord. And he says, what I want you to do is I want you to look ahead of your present situation. He says, I want you to see the victory even before you in the battle. And he says, I want you to see the victory even while you're in the midst of your war. He says, I need you to declare victory even when you feel defeated. And he said to them, he said, I want you to open the window, and I need you to even begin to prophesy your own victory. Because he says, for as many arrows as you shoot, y'all ain't gonna hear me here, out of the window, that is going to be what you have received. And the Bible gives us a New Testament declaration. And he wants you to understand that having that altar done, having that altar stand therefore. And then I borrow an Old Testament, and he said simply this, that the power of life and death is in the tongue. So somebody, you gotta speak your own victory. You gotta begin to declare the victory even when you're in the midst of a battle, when you feel defeated, when you stop just short of your total victory. The Bible says that the prophet, the man of God, opens the window. The prophet puts his hand upon the hand of the king as declaration that God is with you, that the power of God is upon your hand, and everything you put your hands to shall prosper. How many of you in the house today know that you are the apple of the Lord's eye? And whatever you declare according to the word of God, it shall be done. Whatever you do in word or deed, in the name of Jesus, it shall come. When you stop just short of your total victory, the Bible says to the prophet says to the king, as you have shot these arrows, you will get the victory over Syria and Aphek. Now the prophet says to the king, he says, take the arrows that you have remaining and smite the ground. Y'all ain't hearing me. The prophet said, you've already shot to the east, and that's one victory. Yes. He said, but how long do you want to have the victory? How long will you declare the victory in your future? I hear somebody say, I will have the victory in my life. And you smite the ground one time. You said, I'm going to have the victory in my children's life. And you smite the ground one more time. Then you smite the ground again. You say, I'm going to have the victory in my grandchildren's life. And you smite the ground one more time.
But the king stopped after only three times of hitting the ground. And what I'm trying to tell somebody is you grew weary in well doing. You grew weary in praying. You grew weary in expecting God to deliver. You grew weary in God answering your prayers. But when you stopped just short of your total victory, the prophet tells the king, because you stopped, and I didn't tell you to stop, you're only going to defeat Syria three times. He said, but you should have smoked the ground five or six times. Y'all ain't hearing me, somebody. You only prayed three times, and you felt the presence of God. But in high, I told you, you should have stayed there until God gave you the total victory. You should have came back again, and y'all didn't hear me, and again, until the victory was yours absolutely. The other lesson I need y'all to see is that the prophet is on his dying bed, but he still has strength enough to declare, thus saith the Lord. Y'all ain't hearing me here. Don't let the enemy cause you to think because you're getting old or you've got problems in your life that you won't have a word from God. Don't let the enemy cause you to feel because you got situations that you're battling with that you don't have a word from God. Don't allow the enemy to cause you to feel because you are afflicted. You don't have a word from God. Don't allow the enemy to cause you because you got financial challenges that you don't have a word from God. Because you are an apple of his eye. And if you got the power of the Holy Ghost, you got a word from God. If it's just simply repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, you got a word. Come down and hear me here. You got a word from the Lord. Syria had been a longtime enemy of Israel. It always stemmed because somebody didn't do completely what God asked them to do. And Syrians were the types of people, mother, they were, the old people say they were, they had the kind of strength to regroup and come back at you. They were bullies of the worst kind. They like the devil. You may defeat him today, but he'll come back tomorrow. Oh, they like the devil. He'll regroup and study you and come back to your weakness. So the Bible lets us know that because the king did not do what was necessary to see the Assyrians destroyed completely, that at another time later, after Elisha died, the Syrians came and captured Israel. Y'all ain't hear me. So don't let yourself be excited about your present victory. Because the enemy isn't worried about how strong you are today. His seeds are waiting for your weakness. And what I told you, if not last Sunday, but the Sunday before, is his strength is made perfect in your weakness. So that's why you want to send up prayers while you're strong. That's why you want to build your relationship with the Lord while you're strong. So that when you're too weak and you can't utter a number word, you can just lift your hands and say, Lord, remember me, your servant. When you stop, just short of your total victory. Prophet told the king, had you continued to smite the ground, for every time that you hit the ground, you would have had another level of victory. What I'm telling somebody today You've had some victories in your life. But now you're starting to question whether God's hearing your prayers. You're starting to feel a little challenged and even a little overwhelmed. And I'm telling you, you stopped just short of your total victory. What I'm telling you is God didn't tell you how many times to pray or how many times to seek Him. Man says you should not do. And I tell you one simple thing is this. I love the fact that my son keeps coming back to me, asking me to help him with one thing or another. I love the fact that when my son wants affirmation of the things I've already taught him, he said, "Daddy, isn't this right? I did it like you showed me. Look, Daddy, I got it right. Y'all didn't hear me. So it is your Father's good pleasure that you seek Him. Don't let nobody tell you. If you keep praying, it shows a sign of a lack of faith. Honey, the fact that you pray to God shows a sign of fellowship. It shows a sign that I love talking with my daddy. I love being with my daddy because my daddy loves hearing from me and I love hearing from y'all and hearing me." When you stop just short of your total victory. And the Bible tells us in Galatians chapter 6, verse 9, and it says, "Let us not be weary in well doing, for in due season ye shall reap if you faint not." And what I'm telling you, saints, you live for now. You come to this season in life so that you can reap the benefits of holiness. But honey, if you get weary because everything around you is changing, if you get weary because the church is changing, if you get weary because church folks are changing, you will faint and you will lose the harvest. But honey, I'm telling you, don't stop short of your total victory. You gotta say, "I'll go if I have to go all by myself." You gotta tell yourself, "I was made for this. It don't feel good, but I got the victory in Jesus' name. I'm in the midst of it. All the storms are beating at me. It seems like I can't make it, but tell somebody, I'm not gonna stop short of my total victory. I'm expecting a miracle. The sky is the limit to what I can have." Tell somebody, "I'm not dying by the way." It's no wonder someone penned the song, "I got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. I got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. The Holy Ghost done told me everything's gonna be alright. I'm not gonna stop until I got the victory in Jesus. I'm not gonna stop just because the enemy left me this time." For the Bible says your adversary, the devil, goes about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And I'm not gonna be the person who grows complacent and allows the enemy to catch me off guard. But tell somebody, I'm not gonna stop until my victory is declared by Jesus Christ. Doesn't feel good. It's hard when you can't even get people who are connected to you to understand what you need from God. It's hard when you're doing the absolute all that you know. And what I need the church to understand is all that you know and the best you can do isn't good enough. Most of the time. Y'all ain't hearing me. He's old, Pastor, what are you supposed to do? when you've done all you know to do and you've done the best you can do. Then I tell you, stop doing what you know and stop doing the best you can do. Because God didn't ask you to rely on your knowledge, nor did he ask you to rely on your strength. Come on here now, somebody. So what I'm telling somebody is, if what you know isn't good enough to get the task accomplished, then you need to seek God for more understanding.
Yes.
That's why God says, my thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your ways. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my thoughts higher than your thoughts, and my ways higher than your ways. Stop stopping short. Let me say that a different way. Stop coming to the place of where you're about to receive your harvest, but you give up. Either you give up because you were coached, or you gave up because you had no support. You gave up because you didn't know. You gave up because you lost faith. You gave up because you just fainted. The Bible says Elisha knew that he had not given the mantle to know anybody. And although he was on his deathbed, mother, he was still full of strength. Y'all ain't hearing me. Now, the Bible doesn't tell you this in details, but I'm going to say this to y'all so y'all can go away with this one. Because Elisha did not give the mantle to somebody like Elijah gave to him. Elijah went to the sepulcher full of power.
Yes.
He said, now where did you get that from?
Yes.
The Bible says that there was a man spying and he was killed. And when he was killed, they threw his body in the sepulcher of Elisha.
Glory.
Oh, y'all ain't gonna talk to me. And when the Bible says when his body touched the bones of Elisha, meaning he'd been in there a while, because now his body had deteriorated, but he had just a skeleton. The Bible said the man stand to his feet. Y'all didn't hear me. The prophet was so anointed, his bones had the power to raise a dead man. Stop coming to the place where you stop before your total victory. Elijah went to the grave full of power. Don't you die defeated. Don't you die defeated. Don't you die hoping and waiting. When you stop short of your total victory. That's the hope of the believer. Victory is yours. Whether you receive it in your earthly body or your incorruptible body. Victory is yours. Thank you, Holy Ghost.
Amen.
The Bible tells me that even Moses, who was defeated because he misrepresented God, and his one request to God was, let me enter in. And God says, Moses, I can't let you enter in. So God buried Moses. And nobody knew where Moses was buried. But God came to Joshua, his servant, and says, Moses, my servant is dead. But the Bible tells me that Moses died believing.
Yes.
You say, well, how can you get that out of the word, preacher? Because the Bible tells me that when Jesus was on the Mount of Transfiguration and the disciples, Peter and James and John, were there, the Bible said they saw a vision and they saw Moses they were standing in the land of promise. Y'all didn't hear me. So Moses didn't get there in his natural body, but he stood there in his incorruptible body. When you stop just short of your total victory, I'm finished. Y'all can leave here today telling everybody that you know, including the congregation members who are not here today, Pastor preached the shortest message I've ever heard him preach. Because I was not told to make it drawn out. I was told to give the facts. Stop allowing yourself to come just short of your total victory. Your total victory is not dependent on the devil or God. It's dependent on you. How bad do you want it? How bad do you want it? I told you all, the widow woman shut the door and began to fill bottles with oil. But her vision and her faith wasn't as wide, large as mine. Because when I see God blessing, I make provision for as many and as long as the blessing will continue flowing. So I would have kept getting meat vessels until the oil just stopped. I wasn't going to stop the oil. Y'all ain't hearing me. That's why I tell you, saints, it's worth living right. It's worth walking uprightly before God. Because if you've ever been in a dry season where you didn't feel God's hand, you know it's worth it when you feel God's hand all up in your stuff. You know it's worth it that when God bless you, when you just think about it. Y'all didn't hear me. Don't allow yourself to stop showing your total victory. In Jesus' name, stand with me. Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. Father, you alone are worthy of all the praises. Lord, as we stand in your presence, we ask that thou would let this word settle in our hearts and our minds, that you will get the glory for the things that we're becoming. God, help us not to be afraid to sojourn from yesteryear to today, looking forward to tomorrow. God, we know that for every level and every realm, there's a higher calling in our lives. And God, we don't want to just simply accept the initial calling, but we want to fulfill our purpose for which you've called us in you. Bless us, Father. Sanctify our hearts and our minds. Now, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And Lord, as we stand here, we ask that you would remember those that are sick and afflicted. We ask that you would continue to touch Brianna, God. Continue to touch her body. But God, more importantly, give her the mind to be saved. Lord, that whatever condition she finds herself in, she can say, it is well with my soul. And God, even Sister Willis, as she continues to recover, continue to touch her body. Deacon Simeon, God, and Brother Haywood and others that are sick at this hour, God, we ask that you would touch them and let the Shekinah glory rest upon them now. And God, not only do I want to pray for those that are sick and afflicted with disease and other infirmities, but God, I want to pray for those who are mentally ill, God. Lord, as our country and our world has so many people who are mentally diseased and don't even know it, God. And God, those individuals who are connected to them are often burdened down and overwhelmed by the disease or the quietness or the secretness of mental disease and sickness. God, we pray for mental health now. God, we ask that you give, God, that peace, God. Help, God, the people of God. That we would keep in perfect peace as our mind is stayed on you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.